Jalen Hurts had a very good year this season, as he was tied for 7th out of 35 in expected points added, which, if you don't know what that stat is, I have a video that breaks it down. It's awesome because it defines how well a quarterback, offense, and defense is playing, so it's hyper-versatile. In addition to being great in EPA, Hurts was really good in quarterback rating, ranking 11th. His supporting cast, which is based on the PFF grades of his receivers and pass blocking, was ranked 6th overall, so that definitely helped him, but in all, he ranked as my 7th best quarterback, which I think is fair because at his best, he does have top 5 potential, and he wasn't at his best this season, which was for a variety of reasons. He didn't have a great play caller, and I believe he was banged up for a portion of the year as well. Either way, the play calling definitely hindered him, so it makes sense that he wasn't quite top 5, but still, his talent is undeniable at this point, and it makes sense then that he's still roughly in the top 5 picture, even when he's not at his best. At backup quarterback, Kenny Pickett is a very high-end option, as he was a low-end starter. He doesn't wow you with any trait, but he is a solid backup option nonetheless, because he doesn't really make too many mistakes. He just doesn't really make any plays that really help the team in a very intense way. He's going to take what the defense gives him and basically nothing else, which is fine for a backup because you just, at the end of the day, don't want them to lose the game for you, and he's not necessarily going to do that. He's definitely not going to help you win, but he can take what the defense gives. As we move to the supporting cast, if you're enjoying this video, make sure you give it a like, and also subscribe, as both make massive differences. With that out of the way, though, the offensive line for Philly was awesome this year, and perhaps even a little bit underrated, which is crazy because most people do realize that they have a fantastic offensive line, but I don't think they understand to the degree at which it was great, because they were 4th in pass blocking when combining ESPN's pass blocking win rate with PFF's pass blocking grades, so that is elite stuff. And they were 2nd in run blocking when doing the same combination of stats, but for run blocking, of course. So they were very elite in both aspects of the game. And compared to last year, they should be a bit worse, as Jason Kelce retired, which means they'll be without an elite center. Yet Cam Jurgens is still a good option. It might be noticeable at right guard, though, as Mekhi Becton is projected to move from right tackle to right guard, and he wasn't overly solid at tackle last year at his natural position, ranking 66th out of 81 tackles per PFF, so he might not be a great option for guard, but who knows, maybe he plays better at guard. He is a bit oversized, I think, for an interior offensive lineman, because he's about 6'8". But who knows, maybe he is better as a mauling run blocker than somebody that's tasked with being a swift pass protector at tackle. Their depth is not very good. Tyler Steen is probably their most notable depth piece, and he struggled a bit last year. The inside is filled with a bunch of late-round picks that are unproven too, so there's nothing to really be excited for if one of the starters goes down, which is usually the case. There's not too many teams with good depth on the O-line, so they're really going to need to stay healthy if they want their offensive line to be clicking, and if it is, it could still be one of the absolute best in the entire league. Shifting to their weapons, they're again really good. A.J. Brown is an elite number one wide receiver, as he was 8th in yards per game and 33rd in yards per reception, which really goes to show you that in the short to intermediate game, he is absolutely devastating, and he can also win deep downfield. Being 33rd in yards per reception is nothing to scoff at, so he's not just a one- or two-dimensional player. He can win at all three levels of the field, but he does his best work as a run after catch guy and somebody in the short to intermediate game overall, which, even though it is most valuable to be a deep threat nowadays, there's still a lot of value in just being a continual chain mover, which AJ Brown is absolutely. Similarly, Devonta Smith is an excellent wide receiver too, which feels discrediting to refer to him as a wide receiver too, because he's really a wide receiver 1A. He was 21st in yards per game and 35th in yards per reception, so quite similar to AJ Brown. He was a fair bit lower in yards per game, obviously, being 13 spots lower, but I'll take a guy that's 21st in yards per game as my number two. I'm sorry, but that's really good. And Smith, likewise, he can win at all three levels of the field more consistently in the short to intermediate parts, but if the defense becomes lax and doesn't take him as a deep threat seriously, he's going to burn them deep. And I love seeing it because people were wrongly holding it against him that he has such a thin frame, and he's just shown all of those people to be incorrect, as he just is an absolute beast that very rarely gets out physicaled, which is so fun to see for somebody that's just so slim still. For the third option, Jahan Dotson, he's an alright wide receiver 3. He was 94th in yards per game and 81st in yards per reception, so not particularly good at any aspect of the game, but he was much better his rookie year. I'm not sure just how much better his conventional stats were, but he had a much higher PFF rank in his rookie year than he did in his second year, which, as somebody that admittedly doesn't watch very much Commanders football, you can sue me for that if you want, I think that suggests that he was doing a better job of getting open in his rookie year, because that's one thing that PFF takes very seriously, is how open you are as a receiver. So it is something to be worried about. Getting open is the biggest deal for a wide receiver, because it makes your quarterback's job just so much easier. And if you're not doing that, that's just really a hindrance to the whole offense. So it'll be interesting to see if Dotson has a bounce back year or not. Somebody that doesn't need too much of a bounce back year, though, is Dallas Goedert, who is a premier tight end. He was 12th in yards per game among tight ends and 18th in yards per reception among tight ends. He is really, really good. I don't think he gets talked about in the high-end tight end conversation as much as he should, because I'm not going to put him in the Kittle and Kelce conversation, but I think as far as the second and third tier of tight ends go, he's right there, and he's a solid run blocker as well. So he has value all across the board, and he just doesn't get talked about too much as being a very good player, which he is. Somebody that I think gets talked about a little bit too much, though, is Saquon Barkley. In my opinion, he's mainly coasting on name recognition at this point, as he was 35th out of 59 halfbacks in PFF grade. The year before, he was 15th out of 60, so maybe he can be close to worth the contract he got. I think, based on the contract they got, they need him to be what he was the year prior from this past season, meaning 15th, as he is paid like an elite running back, which I just don't necessarily think he is at the moment. He seems to have lost a bit of the juice he had, which is such a massive deal for any running back, but especially a running back like Barkley, who likes to try to turn every run into a 20-plus yard run. So if you lose any bit of speed, that's really damaging. Depth-wise, again, like with their offensive line, Philly is lacking, so they'll need to stay healthy if they want to have success this year. Moving to their defense now, at cornerback, the Eagles are appropriately reloaded, as they really were bad this past season and have changed things up tremendously. They brought in a ton of new talent. The one constant is Darius Slay, who deserves to be back. He was ranked 55th out of 127 in PFF grade for corners, He still has great athletic ability at 6 foot tall, and once being able to run a 4.36 40-yard dash, he still has pep in his step even at 33. He may be on the decline, but his past 2 years, he ranked 21st and 4th out of all cornerbacks per PFF, so he might still have elite play left in him, as if his floor is 55th, I'll take that still. That may sound not great to you, but that's above average, and or roughly above average, I should say. And no, I'm tripping. It is above average. What am I saying? So it is above average, and he is somebody that is definitely going to lead the defense if he can continue playing at the level he's been playing at, which I think is fair to say. Until somebody shows that they're declining, I don't believe that they're on the decline. And so far, Slay really hasn't shown much of a sign, because though he was worse this year than he has been in the prior 2 years, cornerback is a position that's very finicky year to year. So it could just be that the scheme wasn't great for him last year, as they fired the defensive coordinator and brought in Vic Fangio this year, who I think will be getting more out of the players. They had two defensive coordinators last season. I don't think either were particularly getting the most out of their guys. Fangio does have a good track record, so it'll be interesting to see how they fare. For their second corner, Isaiah Rodgers is a solid number two. He was the 5th-ranked cornerback in 2022 when he last played, and was 25th in 2021, so he's stacked back-to-back great years of play, albeit there will be some rust on him, so it might not be guaranteed that he'll be at that high of a level again, but he is somebody that I think will be a clear upgrade over James Bradbury. Somebody that also will be an upgrade over Bradbury is Quinyon Mitchell, who was drafted in the first and was my 8th best player in the draft. Historically, first-round rookie cornerbacks average a 56 PFF grade, which is roughly what James Bradbury had last year, as Bradbury earned a 54 grade. But Mitchell is a bit better than the average first-rounder, so he could be due for a higher grade than that. He's projected to be their nickel right now, which is a bit surprising because he played, to my knowledge, basically exclusively outside in college. So it'll be interesting to see how he fares at a new position, but he has undeniable talent. He was so good in college, and he's so athletic. I think that he has the chance to be really, really good in the pros. At safety, they're rather well set. Reed Blankenship ranked 19th out of 95 safeties in PFF grade. I should say Ed Reed Blankenship. I know that's disrespectful as can be. Reed Blankenship is not at Ed Reed's level, but I love saying that. Blankenship is elite in coverage and not great in run defense, but he is overall a high-end safety, as evident by his PFF ranking. For their strong safety, C.J. Gardner-Johnson is a very solid option. He was ranked 49th out of 88 safeties in 2022 when he last played, and he can get it done as a nickel as well, so he has a lot of versatility to him. Regarding their defensive back depth, Cooper DeJean was drafted in the second and has outside corner, nickel, and safety versatility, which is very rare to see. Most players can play one or maybe two positions, not three, so he is an awesome talent. James Bradbury, he was very poor this past year, but could be due for a bounce back under a new system that doesn't rely on man coverage as much. Avonte Maddox is also really solid as a nickel option, as he's been elite in years past, though he was injured this season, so he might not be as good as he once was. Lastly, Sidney Brown was graded 66th out of 95 safeties according to PFF. He played limited reps, but has the athleticism to be great down the line, as he ran a speedy 4.47 40 and was more than capable in coverage when he did play. So their defensive backs are really good if they hit their ceiling, and they're actually pretty deep now, so they could be really solid on the back end. Shifting to the front seven, on the defensive line, Philly is ferocious and very deep, too. Josh Sweat is a great edge, as he finished 14th out of 122 in edge pressures. He isn't much of a run defender, but he can really get after the quarterback, so that has a lot of value. Similarly, right behind Sweat is Bryce Huff, who ranked 15th, not 14th, in edge pressures. He is similar to Sweat in that he's not good against the run, but he's a little bit different because Huff is actually just terrible against the run and is basically just a designated pass rusher that might be thrusted into full-time play, which is a little bit scary because teams might just run to his side of the field every play with him not being able to set the edge very well. But I'll take it still because he is one of the best pass rushers in the entire league. So that has a lot of value. What also has a lot of value is their interior play, with Jalen Carter ranking 14th out of 142 in defensive interior pressures. So he's an elite pass rusher, obviously. He's also very solid against the run. Some people like to point out that he got a lot of his pressures and sacks in one game. I think it was against Washington. But I saw the talent with him throughout the year, and I think that he's going to be even better this season as he progresses from being a rookie to a second year player. So that's really scary to think because he's already been really good. Additionally, they have Milton Williams, who is a really good interior rusher, being 53rd out of 142 for defensive interior pressures. He's a great run defender too, and got all of those pressures as a third defensive tackle, so he could be even more highly ranked this season. As for the depth on the defensive line, they have a ton of it. If you thought they had depth for defensive backs, that's nothing compared to what they have on the defensive line. Jordan Davis is a great third defensive tackle. He was 67th in pressures and is a really good run defender. Brandon Graham is also an awesome rotational edge, as he was 70th for pressures on very limited snaps. Nolan Smith was selected in the first due to his awesome college career and ridiculous athletic abilities. They also have Jalix Hunt, who they drafted in the third. Since 2019, the average rookie third-round edge has a 63 PFF grade, which would be good for 79 out of 122 edges. So he should be a solid rotational guy as well. That's a lot of depth. They have it on the interior, they have it on the edge. They can rotate guys and always be at 100%, and that is terrifying because they have so much talent. For our final positional group, linebacker, the linebacking core for the Eagles isn't good, despite them spending more resources on the position than they normally do. Zach Bond is alright, as he was very productive in getting after the quarterback and setting the edge in the run game. But he is not too good in coverage. He played more of an edge rushing role in New Orleans this past year than linebacking roles. So he is a bit of a question mark for them as perhaps their linebacker one. Their linebacker two is perhaps the most overrated player in the NFL because some people still think that he's good in Devin White. He's played a lot aside for this year when he was benched for his poor play. He was 80th out of 82 linebackers in PFF grade. He was very poor against the run and is average in coverage despite being a freak athlete, which really shows that he just doesn't have a great feel for the game. The only thing he's shown to be good at is rushing the passer, which is not a very valuable trait for a linebacker. He's basically an edge rusher at linebacker, much in the same way that Zach Bond is an edge rusher at linebacker. So that's a bit wonky. The depth at linebacker is good, though, as N'Kobe Dean hasn't played much in 2 years, but was great in college, so it's hard to say what he'll be. Oren Burks was 64 out of 82 linebackers, which is solid for a third or fourth option. Burks is good in coverage, so he might get some reps, more than you would expect for a backup linebacker, so that could be something, but overall their linebacking core leaves a fair bit to be desired. In all, Philly is a legitimate Super Bowl contender. Jalen Hurts is a very high-end quarterback that's more than good enough to win a Super Bowl. Their offensive line is spectacular, even with arguably their best offensive lineman retiring, and that helps everybody. The receiving options are great, as A.J. Brown is elite wide receiver one, and Devonta Smith is good enough to be a wide receiver one, but is instead one of the best wide receiver twos in the league. Defensively, their defensive line is about as good as anyone's, and it's most likely the deepest in the entire league as well. Their cornerbacks should be improved from what they were last year. If for nothing else, then they won't be tasked with playing man coverage as much as they had to last year. Their safeties are quite good as well. Basically, the only worry I have for them is their linebacker core isn't good, but that's a small issue in the grand scheme of things. Those are my thoughts. Be sure to let me know what yours are in the comment section, and also be sure to like and subscribe for more content.